next thing is about password again, the SNMP, the simple network management protocol, which monitors, remotely administers and monitors the network devices such as switches and routers. This SNMP was in place long years before, and they use something that their passwords, they use something called community strings, which are used to read or access, write access SNMP managed devices. Because SNMP was developed long ago, it's often used to interact with relatively simple network devices, encryption of a password was not a mandatory part of that protocol. The SNMP V3 has now made it mandatory. So the SNMP pre-SNMP V3 protocols, the community strings are totally vulnerable to sniffing attacks. So one of the recommendations here is that whenever you use SNMP, you make it sure that you have SNMP V3 and use community strings which are private, and use a dedicated out of band network for SNMP management and monitoring, and also block offsite SNMP traffic. So many of these words that I have uttered here may not make immediate sense to people who do not have understanding of networking, but towards module 4 and 5 we will try and make these things more understandable to you. But at this point I would like to emphasize that SNMP and SNMP based devices, if you use a version of SNMP which is less than 3, then you are in for problem in terms of password vulnerabilities. The other thing is that people today think that last mail encryption is enough. Suppose I am using a wireless LAN. So when on the system, that is in your laptop or your desktop, where you are going to enable the wireless, you have an encryption protocol. What does that ensure? Between you and the wireless access point, the encryption happens. Beyond that wireless access point, where there is a wire traffic, will it continue to have this encryption? It is not ensured. But there is the feel from the layman who uses this, that when he puts a wireless encryption on his network card, wireless network card, and it is sufficient, the entire traffic is entire data that he is sending is encrypted, which is not the case. When we enable an encryption on a wireless network card, it ensures encryption on transmission of the data from that network card to the access point it is associated with it, and nothing beyond. Even for the encryption between the wireless access card and the access point, the wireless network card and the access point, there are different encryption mechanisms that are listed and used. For example, WEP, WPA, TKIP, etc. But none of these are really that much secure. Today, the best one is the WPA AES or WPA2. If you want, so these are the encryptions that you set on your wireless access card when you are sending data to an access point. And so for more details, we have given a link to a website which can give you more details about attack and cracks on common Wi-Fi networks. The more important thing is, it is not for you to realize that when I encrypt the data which is sent wireless through the Wi-Fi, the encryption happens only to the access point, and beyond the access point how the data is transmitted is not still known. And so if I transmit data through Wi-Fi, though I have put the most sophisticated encryption algorithm, that encryption is between only that access, the card and the nearby access point. So beyond that access point, how the data transmitted, if it is going to be unencrypted, still then the vulnerability that we have stated still exists. The another very interesting problem of security is this evil twin problem. So when we get associated to a wireless LAN, wireless network, an access point, is it that, so let us say there is an access point called A1, and so I see on my screen when I want to associate, I see A1. Is it the same A1 or it is some other A1 which is masquerading or which is mimicking this A1. So that is very, very important. So there is a way by which we can, it is shown that another access point can masquerade this A1, and so instead of associating to that genuine A1, you go and associate yourself to the evil twin of this A1. And why it is evil? Because once you get associated, rather than doing the functionality of a normal access point, which is basically a portal service where it converts your wireless traffic to wired traffic and vice versa, this evil twin access point can basically start sniffing your data and do much more havoc. The 802.1x actually helps to address some of these issues, but the deployment of 802.1x is not painless. Another important reason why passwords are insecure is that though most sites, most of the sites encourage the users to change the password, they say within n months you should change it some k times. But many people ask the question, why should we change this password? What will happen if I keep it like this? And they don't find a justification of why the password need to be changed. But I believe that periodic password changes are actually useful and should be required. Let us go into some reasons of why we should change a password periodically. The periodic password changing will limit what you call as brute force attack. If the password is same, one can keep on trying my account for say some 10 months and he can find out that password. More the time I give for a single password, more easily somebody can do a brute force attack and get the password. If I keep changing it say every day, then somebody cannot go and so the amount of time the brute force attacker gets is only one day. In one day for him to guess my password is going to be difficult, and the next day I am going to change anyway. So more the time if I keep a password the same, the possibility that a simple brute force attack will identify my password is larger. So that is why we need to change the password at regular intervals. What is that interval? That actually depends upon the length and the complexity of the password. If I have a large password or a very complex password, then I may not change it for say 1 year or 2 years. But if I have very simple passwords, then I may need to change it very quickly. And another important thing about password is that suppose I have a system and I am logging into the network and I am actually asking the browser to save all these login information, password information, and one day the system does not boot and somebody comes and tries to retrieve, nothing happens. So I tried to discard that system, but please note I am going to discard it along with the disk, and I don't do anything with the disk. So someone goes and takes the disk and retrieves the information. Obviously, he is going to get some information about the passwords that I have stored there, because I have used the web browser etc. to save all my password. So the other person who is actually a silent trader can basically get access to the password. And suppose I don't change the password at all, the person who got access to the old system can coolly use that password and access all my accounts. So this also ensures that, this also is a very valid point, that we should keep changing our password at regular intervals. So password changes make it harder for users to reuse passwords on multiple sites. So we tried and use only one password for all the sites, because it's very, very difficult for us to remember a mapping between sites and password. This site uses this password. It's very difficult for someone to map this. So requiring periodic password changes means that we need to keep changing passwords at different sites. So many people do, they have one password for all the sites they have access to. And if one of those sites say that the password needs to be changed, they go and change the password for all the sites. So if an hacker gets this password, then he can go and hack all the sites with this password. So that's the drawback of having a single password for all the sites one use. But many times you can't keep people from shooting themselves in the foot. And another thing is that many times people hard code the password and forget the password. Hard code in sense, they will ask the browser to remember, and they will say, okay, I don't need, browser will remember. But on the other hand, if the user is asked to change the password every 3 months, then, and when changing the password I need to remember my old password, so this hard code and forgetting of password will reduce. So normally we don't tend to ask the web browser to remember the password, because if we go and ask the web browser to remember the password, then the old password would be forgotten by you. Since you have to change the password every 3 months, you need to remember the old password, at least the last one password for a system, and that will force you not to use this hard code and forget the password. And if you don't hard code and forget the password, then the chances that it leaks because of local storage reduces considerably. And there is also the notion of some phishing attack, right, which goes and says, you know, please change your password. It's a very interesting attack. So there will be a mail saying change your password, and then you start sniffing the network. So you receive a mail from a hacker, say change your password, and from that moment he starts sniffing the traffic that goes on your network. And whenever you change the password, he knows what is the new password or a hash of the new password, and he can basically go and start cracking your password. So one of the thing is, every user should be educated on what is the duration by which they need to legitimately keep changing their password. So if a sudden request comes which is before this duration, then the user can know that this is a spam message and not a genuine message. So this recurring password changes actually provide what we call as a teachable security moment. People should understand that they are part of a secure society, and if something wrong they do, that will cause lot of damage not only to them but all the systems that are connected to them. So many users do not come for training sessions related to security in many organizations. So things like you should change your password, you should not write your password, all those things become unknown to many people who don't give a big care for sitting through training programs on security, or organizations who don't really care for security. Now, if you say that every 3 months you need to change, the user now at least remembers once in 3 months that there is something called password, and that password should not be disclosed, and this is coming because of a security requirement. So the word security will be registered at least once in 3 months whenever a user is forced to change his or her password. So that is why we call this password change as a teachable security moment. So the other thing is that whenever you initially assign passwords, they are some random values or some derived values like date of birth, etc. So it is, so when you open an account, first a default password is set, and that password, if it is genuinely random, then it is good, but many times it is not random. It is derived from the user's data, like the user's date of birth or some constant string like change me now, etc. We have seen about default passwords for many devices, but this is default password when we try and open an account with some remote server. There are many, many services like POP, IMAP, where you never even go and log in again. So many times this password remains the same in with that default value, and if it remains the same, then it is actually a threat for password stealing. So so this is very similar to what we call as a one time reset link, right? So whenever you ask for a reset and you go and click that reset, so an unencrypted email is sniffed, which is, see, your the request for a reset, you go and ask a server to reset your password, and for that it will send you a link which will for which you can use to go and reset the password. Now this email comes to you in an unencrypted form. So an hacker who is watching your traffic will know that you are now trying to reset a password for a particular link. From that point of time, if he starts monitoring your network, he can actually go and find out, if he starts hacking into your network, if he starts sniffing your network, he can find out what password you are going to set. So there is a very, very interesting discussion in the URL that we have given in the PDF file, whose URL we have shared here, which talks about forget my password and what happens next. And password reset is also not a very difficult task many times, because the questions asked for resetting a password is also very trivial, and it could be guessed. For example, the date or place of birth, mother's name, father's name, social security number, last four digits of a social security number, etc., your first employer, your favorite dog or cat, your favorite ice cream. Many of these informations are there in many of the social networking sites like your Facebook. I had a wonderful vanilla ice cream today, then they know that your favorite flavor is vanilla. And these have very low information entropy, because if you the majority, if you say again ice cream flavor, mostly the answer can be vanilla, sometimes strawberry, and in some rare cases, say butterscotch. And there are also some things which are genealogical databases, which has the complete history of your family history, your entire tree, family tree. From this, you can go and easily guess your birth date, your mother's name, your mother's second uncle's third daughter's husband's name. Anything could be guessed from this genealogical tree. So, the way password gets reset allows, there are two ways. One is a reset link, and then somebody can sniff this email transactions by which you go and reset a password, or it can also be through handling some trivial questions, which again anybody can guess, answer, and reset your password and get to know your password. So, passwords, so to conclude here, passwords do have problems, and the way these problems could be addressed is to have what we call as a two-factor authentication. One of the important data security standard, which is the payment card industry data security standard, essentially says that one level authentication is not enough, and they insist on a two-factor authentication. Thank you. Next.